Yeah, so I already introduced myself. I will talk about protocol-oriented programming. And this is short agenda for today. We'll start with some kind of intro to protocols, our protocols application, also comparing to object-oriented programming a bit. And later on, we'll go to straight POP and new Swift protocol tricks, and then we're gonna sum up everything. So, what are protocols? If you know the synonyms of protocols, you probably know what protocols are. It's some kind of contract interfaces, the behaviors that actually classes or different entities has. So this is this area of our interest. And these are the semantics for iOS protocols. The first one is from Objective-C, second one is from Swift. It's a bit easier. And we probably all of us know that, so let's skip to the first question. Why Objective-C protocols should extend NS Object Protocol? Do anybody know? Or want to answer? Okay, I will probably answer if you are interested this in the end, personally, then. Okay, let's take a quick example. So let's take a closer look to a class. So class consists of type, behavior, and state. Type is purely name of the class, so this is quite easy, straightforward. And behavior are methods, and state are properties. This is, everybody knows that, so this is the example. We have a class engineer with two public methods. The private methods are like implementations, details. So from perspective of different objects, we actually don't care about it at all. So the public method are actually the ones we care about. So we can actually extract those to a protocol. So it looks like this, fairly easy. And now the we conform to that protocol engineer and take a look that we change the class name. And right now, those classes that we extracted the protocol need to be implemented here also. So it's not different, but if you take a different class and you interact with this type that we created, the engineer, we see only those two declared methods. And the thing here that is actually really good, that we are coupled to behavior, not the class itself. So we are more free, I would say, less coupled, and that's actually really good thing. So let's jump to our implementations, our applications of protocols. I'll introduce you our class analytics, which is which main job is actually to send an events about analytic stuff that going in the app. So for example, any clicks, any swipes, any visit of the screens, this kind of stuff. And we have two libraries that we're gonna send to the event, KidsMetrics library and Google Analytics library. And the implementation of the send event methods looks like this. So it's really simple right now. And we have a private API for those libraries. So we're gonna use them as they are proposed to us. But if actually the requirements for this method are going to get wider, we're gonna end up with something like this, like two new libraries here. Yeah, it's still quite simple, it's okay. But for example, if we want to check if some kind of event was sent the first time to in our app, like occurred first time, and only then send it to some kind of library, then we're gonna end up like this. So it's still not super complicated, but the implementation here grows with growing requirements. So it's gonna grow. And this is not the cleanest solution, I would say. And what we can do about it? Let's take a closer look to the O principle in Solid, which is OOP principle set. It's open close principle. And it's going like this. Objects or entities should be open for extension, but closed for modification. That means that you want to extend the functionality of the object from outside the object, not changing the actual code inside the class. So let's take a look to the example for this, or our implementation of this principle. We create an event processable, its protocol. Its only job is to process some kind of event, so that's simple. And we're gonna adapt this protocol to our libraries. There are two approaches. We can extend our library to get this method, and inside this method we'll use the private API as before, or we can create another entity, another type, and then with composition we get the library inside and also use the private API. So that's how we're gonna adapt to this protocol, use this type. And for example, if you want to implement the first time event as we had there, this logic, we can do it somewhere like this. This is a bit implementation, not the proper one, but we're still gonna implement this type. And we're gonna end up with the analytics and send event implementation like this. We're gonna stack every event processable as a type, these protocols, and use them, iterating by them with the for in, and then just send every event inside this type. So to compare, we just, from something like this, we ended in something like this. Bang, bang. Okay, so we have a new requirement, for example, to our analytics class. And this is to log everything to console. Like every event that we send it to analytics, we're gonna log into console with an slot. So what can we do? We can create another type, another entity, print process, that is conforming to event processable. And inside the process event method, we're gonna NS log every event. And what we have to do actually to extend our functionality from outside the class of analytics, we just add it to the event processable collection. So that's all we have to do to extend the functionality there. So yeah, it's really good. So we have another question. Do Swift protocols have optional methods? Anybody else? Yes, no?
No.
No? They have implementation, but only if they inherit from Objective-C runtime. Yeah, it's Swift still. It's Swift semantics, but not Swift runtime. Who told that? can we talk later on?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay, second example. Mocking with protocols. We have a simple class of API client that make a request for data, and in return we have the closure with the Facebook posts, collection of Facebook posts, so that's really easy class. And let's define some kind of screen, a UID controller that has this client and make a request inside the fitted log, and after return we just populate the posts. That's our requirement here. And what is wrong with actually this approach? If you want to work on UI and UX or UX in this screen, you will always have to make this request every time you want to iterate the screen or test your screen. So it's kind of inconvenient, and you're kind of dependent on this if your service is actually run or is dead. So if it's dead, you cannot test it each time. And this is implementation, like production implementation. So what you can do about it? So let's define like Facebook post repository with one method, getPost, really similar to the previous one, that will return a collection of the Facebook posts, and we will create another type, API client Facebook post repository, that conforms to that method, to that behavior, and we're gonna invoke this request for data method inside, just as it was before, Or more preferred semantics, we can extend the API client to this protocol. That's also cool. And implementation inside our UIV controller, it looks like this. So we only change the type here, which actually has a bit different name of the method, but that's a detail right now. And the rest of it is the same. So we didn't alter the implementation of this UIV controller, like probably none, like just a bit. So another step here, we will create a mock Facebook post repository that conforms to the same protocol. And inside it, we'll create an array of mocked posts that actually we can customize in our way as we want. And each time we will ask it, they will be provided to us. So this will be automatic and really quick, like synchronously actually. So what we gain with that, we have in the end faster development. You can customize the mock objects. We don't have to wait for the server or any API clients to define those objects for us. We can like make the contract of the object, create them, mock them, and then wait for implementation from API side. And what's actually cool, we can define what kind of data source, like if we want to mock the object, or if we want to use API client repository, we define it outside the PostV controller. So if you want to change that, you don't have to go into the screen and change it. You define it outside, like in the practice way. So one of the ways I would like to use, it's abstract factory pattern, where you can mock a large scope of the of your application, not only like this screen, but you can define like this kind of factory, which will inject it, I don't know, for example, the whole feature or whole app if you want. So you can do it like that. Yeah, I give a tip for that. And a bit more hard example, but really similar to previous one. Let's take a look to the navigation class, the navigation struct actually, navigation entity, which our only job is to handle URL that going inside our app, the URLs that you are universal links, this kind of stuff, and you are translated into some kind of controllers, some kind of screens inside your app, and show it to the user. And our two dependencies are present table and navigation create table types. And this is how they look like. First is only to show the controllers. That's really easy. And second one is to create a UIV controller from some kind of name. Like if you define the name for login, you will send a login in the URL, like this name. And we defined the class present table spy, which conform to the present table. We do it the same with the navigation create table. And we are using two variables that will be captured. Actually, our present table spy object was used by in our dependency as a dependency. And we're going to capture the controller that was passed in the show method. And we'll just in a second see how it looks like in tests. So our test class looks like this. You're going to create this print table spy and just inject it inside the navigation here and here. And our real unit test looks like this. We just invoke the method that we had, go to your URL, and then we provide some kind of URL. And then we're going to check it if the show method was used, actually here, and if this URL was handled by the navigation class. So we're going to test up two things. And second test is example of navigation create table, if it actually was used, and if the navigation ask a navigation create table spy for the fixture screen name that is provided here. We just check it, is it properly passed. So these are our tests. And if you just use like normal present view control present view controller method on navigation, if you pass like normal UIV controller there, you will not test this kind of stuff because maybe method switching or something, but this is really hard. Last example of our applications on protocol are extracting the God classes. God classes are classes that basically does everything. So you will want to extract those to have a proper defined object, a proper defined structure, architecture. And in our example, we had navigation router that was capable of switching between loading and main at speed, like on the window level, handle URLs, creating and displaying UI controllers. This is what exactly do this factory, navigation create table and present table doing right now, and switching between tabs in our app. So this was only 200 lines of code, but strongly coupled code and coupled to custom classes. And it was really hard to extend on the iPad or, I don't know, any different way of showing things. Like, this was really hard to work with. So basically, we just extracted those kind of protocols from it, then basically moved the implementations outside the class and just created like few different entities from that. Like, for example, this navigation that I showed before was extracted from this class, and present table, navigation, create table. So yeah, this is a good thing. And this is pure example of interface segregation, that if you want to have always a lot of small interfaces, then one big interface with all of the jobs that it has to do. Okay, let's move to POP. I have the second question, or the third question actually. Do protocols can have implementations? Anybody else?
Yes.
That's true. From Swift 2.0, it can have it. Okay, what's POP? Basically, you have to start with protocol. Everything that you define in your app, in your architecture, you should start with a protocol. Second thing is to use the value types. That's basically all. And a quote that I read on Kraken Dev blog, it's at the heart of the protocol-oriented programming is abstraction and simplicity. And this is actually something the closest of how I understand the POP. So you don't have to be like totally not working with objects or something, like not working with value types. You just have to be abstract, simple, and with protocol. So that's why the object-oriented principles, I still agree with them, because here's the abstraction, polymorphism, which is look at four examples of it before, and encapsulation also. I just don't like inheritance, right? I do it barely close to nothing. So that's one of the things I don't agree with. And what are value types? Because we mentioned it, but didn't talk about it at all. It's just a type whose value is copied when it's assigned to something. And the result of that, the implication of that, is that it has only one owner, but the state of the object that you have will not be changed inside of you. So this is something a bit different than maybe in a different way. That's. Okay. This is something different than reference types, which you actually can have on object a few owners, and your state of the object that you have can be changed, and you probably will not know about it at all. So this is the main advance from value types here. Okay, let's skip to some example. Our requirement for now is to neatly handle errors, so let's create an UI alert view. We defined a class with static methods to be simple, and we created like in really normal way UI alert view with some kind of description, and it's straightforward and short. If we catch an example, if we catch an error, and I strongly recommend to use NSError if someone not using it, it's really a usable thing. Before we just inherited. Create a class from it, and that wasn't a good idea. And NSError is purely managing everything.
Okay.
This is example of usage of this kind of error handler. We just extended the request for data example with the failure closure, and when we get an error here, we just handled it like this. And it's really easy. We have a static access to this method.
Cool
enough. But actually, we are kind of coupled to the error handler class. So if you want to change it in the future, we have to change it in every place that we actually use it. So that's not a cool idea. What we can do a default implementation, and we can define protocol error handleable with the method handle error, which we will extend. This is semantics for extending and making default implementation in Swift. And we define it with the handle error, and we create the same alert view as before. And in usage, it looks like this. We just define ourselves that we conform to error handleable, and we just use it by using self. The same thing. We just inherited this kind of behavior from the protocol. And actually, if you want to make a custom implementation of that because you are conforming to this method so you can implement it, you can do it. You can do it your custom error handler if you want in some kind of screen or elsewhere. Okay, going back to our other view, it looks like this. We have a small problem here. Your alert view is deprecated in iOS 8, so it's probably time to skip to UI alert controller. So let's do that. And it looks like this. Okay. This is still our default implementation, but the error handler doesn't have a member present in controller because this is not an UI view controller. So this is going to be hard a bit, but we can do it something like this. We can narrow our scope of default implementation to UI view controllers only. And only if UI view controllers inherit the conforms to the error handleable protocol, it will get that implementation. None of the different objects will get that. So that's kind of cool. And now we can use the methods from the UI view controllers here by using myself in default implementation still. So yeah. How to split actually a default implementation. So let's get back to the first example that we had. Like we have read specification and write code methods, and we're gonna extend this engineer protocol with self, where we are corporate developer, and we are reading very long specification here. So let's try to use it and compile it. Are we not conformed to this protocol? Why is that? Because we are implemented it here as default, but yeah, we are lacking of one method here from whole protocol. Okay, that's okay. So we can split default implementations actually. If you using a default implementation, you don't have to implement the whole protocol inside this implementation. You can just implement a few of the methods, and the rest of it will still be needed to implement in your class. So let's change a bit this protocol, and let's say that we want to check if we can do pair programming with different engineer simple method. Returns bool if you can do pair programming, and false if you cannot. So let's check the corporate developer, and corporate developer has a department name, and if both guys are actually the same department name, they can pair program, but we have an error here. Do you know why?
Not comparable.
Yeah, that's actually the best answer. We are not the same type, and type engineer doesn't have department name. Department name is the part of corporate developer. So what we can do here, we can cast down. Yeah, that's working, but not really. In the static typed languages, you shouldn't cast. You shouldn't cast at all, because you are wasting your pure compilation time and kind of safety nets that there are there, and you are just making a bit dynamic language from a static type, and you don't want to do that at all. So what we can do with our protocol to change it? We can do something like self-requirement and define it like this. And right now, this whole symbol with actually this method in the let's go to example, maybe it will be easier. In the class that's gonna conform to this protocol, we should change that cell to actual class that conforms to the protocol. So if we are corporate developer that conforms to engineer, here we'll be corporate developer. So that works pretty fine right now.
So if we pass the engineer instead of the corporate developer, the method, the compiler wouldn't allow us?
If you pass, if it, the text that you are making that on corporate developer, not on a different class that, for example, our engineer, it will not pass that. Yeah, it will check that on compile level. And actually, why is that? If we define ourselves as, if we define the protocol with self-requirement like this, we cannot do something like this. We actually are losing the possibility of defining our protocol as type. So that's a pretty bad thing if you compare to our first four examples of usage of protocols. So yeah, it's something that you can do, but what it's actually allowing, we can use it as a constraint. So a constraint to generic. So it will only allow those T types, described as T, that conforms to engineering. But here, you will only have the T class, not any different that conforms to engineer. So it allowing only that one class. What actually you can see better when you have collections. You will have collection not on the engineer type, but you will have collection of the T type. So this is kind of homogeneous collection. Consists only from one type of object. And if we extend actually our conformance to three protocols, this is gonna get quite bigger right now. So, we can do it like this. Now we are defining to one protocol. Yeah, we can actually combine protocols with this kind of notation inside the suite. And we can add actually also a type alias, which is kind of handy. I strongly recommend that. And you can define all of the requirements for conformance inside the protocol. Yeah, it's quite nice if you do it actually. It's not so heavy to read. We are coming to an end. And to sum up all of the stuff, I strongly recommend start building with protocol. That's gonna get you guys stuff really easier. Use protocols to correctly define your entities' relationships, that define your jobs like really, really proper. Why we should use value types? Because they don't have mutable, shared or mutable state that we talked about before. We have copies instead. Copies are cheap still because it's values only, consist of structs, ints, and etc. And we have like language sweep mechanism that enforces immutability. Immutability. Okay, I will leave it. And it will always complain about it if you do something wrong. Why or where I should use classes? Sometimes you will need a shared state. Yeah, sometimes you will need it. So probably then you will use those classes. The whole UI kit is built on classes, so inheritance there. For example, UI controller, you have to inherit different UI views and stuff and stuff. So you have to inherit there and use classes. And actually, my opinion on that is that copying stuff will not fix your architecture. If you do something wrong, the copying stuff will not fix all your bugs in your application. So that's only my opinion on that. Good practices, keep extensions of the protocol in the same file as the protocol, keep extensions of the class with the same file as class. That's from Ray Benderlich style guide, which you can find in here, and you can find in the presentation later on. And as I said, this is in class, and you are adding conformance in extension. That's pretty convenient. Swift only. Default implementations are not transformable to Objective-C. Optional methods can be applied to structs or enumerations. And this is actually the implication of the first one. So. Second thing is, how do we use optional methods in Swift? The same as optional types. Like here, just a question mark after the symbol of the method. So that's all, guys. Thank you. Does anybody want to ask something? Okay. Thank you again. And what we do now? Oh, yeah.
What's about this object in protocol?
Ah, yeah. The answer here is actually, if you want to have this type, because you use it later on as a type, this protocol, you will have to have it as an object actually, and you want to have like full object functionalities, for example, like response to selector or take a class from it or this kind of stuff. So inheritance on NS objects give you all of the stuff that is called actually the first class object in your application.
Thanks.
Okay, Marcin. Shall we continue or who probably say?